Welcome everyone to our weekly top 10 list with me, John Arola, and Francesca Fiorentini. Francesca, thank you for being here.
No problem, man.
It's weird. So today we are going to be breaking down 10 ways that you can almost instantly know that someone is a big old jerk. And I did this because people have been saying the lists haven't been substantive enough recently, and I wanted to make sure that we balance the scales. So what to you is your number 5 reason that you know instantly that someone's a big old jerk?
There's a lot of things, but I'll start lightweight. Use your effing turn signal. I'm sorry. If I'm in the car, if I'm in the car, if I'm out of the car, just like, I love how a-hole drivers always think everyone else is the a-hole. If you've been in the car of someone who like doesn't signal, speeds, and is like insanely reckless, but like thinks that everyone else is the problem. Like, no, you're the problem. But specifically,
I'm
it's that turn.
About me.
Dude, it's a turn signal, man. Just because you drive an Audi doesn't mean you don't have to effing turn, like turn on your turn signal. I don't care if you're pulling into your own garage. Turn your goddamn turn signal
on.
Think
it should just be automatic. You shouldn't have to think about it.
Like, it is for me, it's automatic because I am courteous and I don't like when people are not courteous. And you know, obviously, if you don't get the thank you wave, that's bad. But just the TS, that's all.
That used to be one of the driving things that bothered me the most, and I still don't like it because it's so easy. But there are now driving related things that bother me so much more that they might appear on the list. We will see. One for me, and obviously the word jerk or a-hole, whatever it is that's being put on this list, can be defined very broadly in a lot of different ways. But one thing that to me sort of clues me in that a person's not necessarily someone I want to associate with is people whose social media is used to present this really faux aggressive idea of who they are. Like when all their Facebook statuses back in the day would be about like, I don't let no one F with me. If they step to me, I'm gonna what? Like, it's like, dude, this is totally unnecessary. Why is this how you feel you need to present? Like, you just seem like a person who's gonna be really, like, their life's filled with drama and I don't wanna be around you. You're gonna be looking for fights and everything. And that to me, I don't experience that with the sort of people that I work with or associate with. But like back when I used Facebook and I would see updates from people that I went to like high school with and stuff, that was one of the designators, was the need to present this like avatar. And I never got what the like the psychological appeal of that was. It just seems like
you've missed social media altogether. That's all social media.
No, I get making an avatar. I clearly try to do that to some extent, but the idea that you just constantly are getting in fights with everyone around you, it's like when someone says that everyone they've dated is crazy. Like at some point,
yes,
there's a common denominator. I don't know. Anyway,
oh,
that's my
that is such a dead giveaway. And that's not, I mean, it doesn't, you don't really get that information up top. But when people say like, oh, I've dated nothing but crazy bitches, you're like, oh, I think you're the one. Yeah, you're right. Okay. Number 4 for me is gonna be resentful chivalry. I hate it when men, I hate it when men like open the door or let you go first and then do a thing where they're like, yeah, you're welcome. Like it happens a lot, especially in this country and moving from like Latin America.
Who does that?
A lot of people, tech bros in San Francisco do that. Or people who are like letting you go first, and men do it all the time when they're like, they're doing something nice and it's like, just do something nice and then let it be great. Like just do it. And yet there's a resentment. There's a like, I guess I gotta, but I thought feminism, but and like, so there's a little bit of like snark attached to it. And I hate that.
Let me ask you this. Is it okay? So if I see that someone is approaching a door and I start to open it, is it okay to expect that they will slightly speed up, or is that resentful?
No, I mean, I think it's fine, but like, just don't do the like.
Okay, well, I don't think I've ever done that face. I'll be on the lookout.
No, John, you're a perfect man, an ally.
Well, thank you. I try to be. I haven't really experienced that, but I guess I'm a guy, so that's a privilege that I haven't had to deal with that. Okay, so mine, now we're gonna get into pettier stuff. A lot of mine is petty. That's the general thing that lets me know that someone's a jerk. So for me, one of the things that I don't know if I say this much on the show, but in my personal life, my wife has had to deal with me saying a lot. We're trying to have a society. There's these little things that we're all supposed to do because they're easy individually for us to do them. But when we don't, it makes it worse for everyone. Yes. And the example I will give, I think I might have mentioned this on the show months ago. There, I was at a Lowe's, and Lowe's in the parking lot has the things that you push your cart into. And so there was one of those, and apparently the first person who went to put their cart in there just put it in front of the thing, not pushing it into it. And then the next person said, well, this ain't my problem, so they just put it next to it. And eventually it created a crescent moon of carts that not only blocked the entire entrance to the cart rack, which was empty, but my car was totally blocked off by a bunch of carts that I had to deal with.
Well, your and car is the size of a cart, but yes.
I normally park in those cart things.
Yeah.
But all it would have taken is a little bit of a push and everything would have worked. It's just those little social niceties that when you drop something and you don't pick it up, like you spill a little bit of a drink and you don't pick it. It's just these little things that it's this simmering thing where you don't want to be a part of the solution. We experienced a lot of that during the pandemic. Like when I go to the gas station and there's the window that shows you what you owe and someone's scratched it. It's just like, can we just have a society? Can things just, why are you the Joker? Why did you become the Joker?
You just sound like a dad. The Joker is just scratching off the
they want to see the world burn.
Window.
That's what they want. They want to see the world burn. And they maybe if they could press a button and send the earth off its axis, spinning out into deep space, they would. But the only thing they can do now is they can scratch up that little window.
That's what's so your funny. Three? I want you to leave a little note. I want you to leave a sticky note. You think you just want to watch the world burn. This is your way of getting back. But we live in a society. John should leave. John, I want John to leave like a little, we live in a society post-its around all the things that he finds reprehensible. That shopping cart thing is obnoxious as hell.
That's so annoying.
So mine is the flip side of the chivalry is when you hold a door for a woman, specifically in a bathroom, and you don't get a thank you. I'm sorry. You're an anti-feminist. You're throwing, there is a special place in hell, as Madeleine Albright said. But for women who don't say thank you when other women hold the door open for them in a bathroom. Like it happens all the time. And you're like, excuse me, what am I, a man? I'm kidding.
Can I ask a follow-up?
I thank men when they hold the door open for me too. Yes, what's the follow-up?
When you have held the door open and they walk through and don't say it, do you do this?
No, because I'm happy to hold the door open. Absolutely happy to hold it. When I don't get a thank you, I'm like, you know, and then I say the C word. That's the beginning of C word, you know, and then I freak out and then I start filming them and then, you know, I go viral on WorldStar.
In a bathroom. That's dangerous.
Yeah. No. Yeah. The difference is when you hold a door, know that you're doing like that's something on you. Like it's nice. And it's true. I shouldn't do it to get a thank you. You're very right. You don't do things to get things. But I just want a little thank you.
I thank people when they do it. But now that I think about it, I don't think people often hold the door for me. But that's fine. I can open it. Anyway, my number three is going to be very basic one. I think a lot of people can agree on this. And this is because I have worked in every aspect of this industry. When someone is like waiting on you, serving you, and you treat them like absolute garbage.
Yep.
I was a waiter for years. I was a barista for years. I was a bartender for years. I was a caterer for years. I was a busboy for years. It's just, it's the letting the world burn. It is the, I am going to, whatever opportunity I have, that's what I'm going to use. I'm going to scratch this thing up or whatever power I have, even if the only power I have is over this waiter, I'm going to use that. Feel good. I want to feel like a lord in England. And I hate it. I've seen waiters and waitresses that I've worked with break down crying from the way they've been treated. And there's a lot of aspects of work where people don't get the respect that they deserve, but that is very much one of them. And this is my experience is all way back before some of the Karen stuff and COVID and all that. I can only imagine how much worse it is now.
Agreed. I super agree with that. I've not worked as many waiting jobs.
I'm surprised. I would have
server jobs. Yeah. Well, a couple. I'm a terrible server. I spill stuff on people. I like, anyway. I'm a terrible server.
Okay, but what's your number two?
My number two is also living in the world as a woman, you will come across a type of man who will not look you in the eye. Just, and it doesn't mean he's looking at your chest. It doesn't, whatever. Like, I'm like, at least you're looking at me. But if you're with another man, this man will only look at that man and not you. You're invisible. In fact, I mean, you could be like in a whole circle and you've got like man, woman, man. And the dude only looks at the men in the group like, oh yes, the decision makers. I'm sorry, I'm speaking to the voters. Like what? I'm speaking to the property holders. Like, and it's so, I think it's unconscious. And again, I don't think it is like, you know, open misogyny and not awful, but it's like, it is very telling as to how someone feels about women, how they feel about women's opinions, whether they're gonna stick around if you start to speak or talk. And it has happened a lot to me. And I think for young women especially, it happens more. And I think maybe young guys make this mistake more often, but that's just my experience. It's such a giveaway that you're gonna be an a-hole.
Do you think, or do you even care, whether it's they don't even think to look at you because they preemptively don't think you'll have an opinion or whatever? Or do you think it's one of those like women as property things where they don't want to look at the woman because what if the guy thinks I'm looking at his woman? Do you think it's one or the other, or do you not care either way?
I don't care what the rationale is. I don't care if it's you think, oh, I think she's pretty, I don't want to look. Like, it doesn't, literally doesn't matter. It comes out sexist however way you cut it. Like, I'm sorry, but you're clearly talking to a group of people. You're clearly talking to us. So, you know, that's it.
You know, I'm curious because you mentioned this at the beginning. So you've been a woman for years. So how frequent would you say it is that you catch men looking not at your eyes, like at some other part of your body? Is this a very frequent thing off in the world?
No. I'm not that well endowed. And I think it can be a curse when you are. But I do notice when people like sneak glances. And trust me, I've snuck a glance or two at men. Don't get me wrong. You know what I'm saying? Like, sometimes you
just want to see how well turned his calf is.
Yeah, obviously. But you definitely notice when someone's like looking at your like different parts of your body, and you're just like, ugh. We're both gonna pretend that didn't happen.
Nice little confidence.
You gotta be subtle about it, you know?
Yeah. Anyway, my number two is one very core to me. It's why I have always despised and distrusted J.R. Jackson. It's just people who aren't into animals. And I know for a lot of people, they would define this as people who don't like animals. But no, I think you should be an active enthusiast in terms of animals. And especially in this time, I think that being into animals, either like academically or wanting to go see them or fostering them or owning them, I just think, or having them be part of the decor of your house, I just think it reflects well on a person.
Decor of your house.
Well, no, like for instance, you need my to have shower a few curtain raccoons. Has birds.
Yes, there need to be a few raccoons wearing like aprons. Somewhere. There's
that sounds awesome, and I would be into it. No, really, I think like think about when you hear that like a politician doesn't like animals, when Trump will like talk about dogs. It just tells you something. Like, you should be able to get along with creatures other than humans. I don't think that's asking too much.
Does JR not like animals?
It's hard to say for sure. He has always said that he doesn't like dogs, and he talks a lot of S about his dog Sprocket, who's out in the main bullpen right now. I think he actually likes Sprocket, but he loves to pretend that he doesn't, which is weird. Anyway,
I think the whole must love dogs and or it's just kind of as dumb as also. I don't think you have to love dogs, but I also, it is a red flag when you're like, oh, I absolutely hate cats.
Okay. You made it about cats. I knew you would.
Of course.
Okay, what's your number one? What beats all the rest?
I just want to clarify, John, you don't like music. So
I like it fine. I'm mostly joking. I like it fine.
It's such a funny defense to music.
Okay.
Like, I like it fine, which doesn't mean that you don't like it. Like, you're
there. I just don't want to go to a place. Like, music to me is something in the background. It is not the thing I'm doing, whether at home or another place. I've been to a few concerts that were okay, but I would never sit in my room and just have music on and that's the thing I'm doing. I think that
that's weird. What did you do when you were 16?
I watched movies, I watched TV, I played sports, I didn't date or anything. I guess I wasn't doing that, but anyway, no, it's just not a primary activity to me. And I also think it's very weird. I can't conceive of knowing when an album is gonna come out.
Or like, okay, you don't have to know that.
Like, I know when the next Thor is coming out, but I couldn't imagine like, oh, I can't wait for Taylor Swift's new album to come out next month. Like, I cannot conceive of how you'd even know that. Okay. Anyway, I'm apparently the bad guy now. What's your number one?
My number one is one of yours. And obviously it is the key indicator whether someone's gonna be an a-hole, which is being rude to waitstaff. It's the most basic, it's a perfect stranger literally delivering you food. That you like, just like they pretty much are doing everything except spoon feeding it into your mouth. And if you have the audacity to like, there's a few things. There's the snap. There's the ch-ch-ch, that's the worst. Like,
oh, I've treating never them seen like, that.
It's, I mean, ch-ch-ch, like someone, people do that. And obviously being a bad tipper. Like, I'm sorry, we're in a 20% world, and I think that's what we gotta go with. Until we have a wage raise, or until we eliminate the tipped wage in order to raise wages of servers generally, and we have to make sure there's healthcare and benefits and all the other things. Yeah, we're working in a 20% tipped world.
I get it. Yeah, and like that might make it unreasonable for people to go out, but you don't have to generally. I mean, for the most part, or there's other alternatives. If you don't want to pay for the service, there's places to buy food where you don't have to pay for the service. That is the thing. And I will say that was on my list. I've had a lot of experience with that on like the receiving end and seeing it as a waiter. I haven't really experienced much of it from people I've gone out to eat with, thankfully. A little bit sometimes with new people. Generally, I don't stick around them, but thankfully I haven't had to see it a lot. Anyway, my number one actually was on your list, although not for the same exact reason. I think, and this is similar to my, they just wanna see the world burn. When a particular form of anonymity, and it isn't, I guess, although a lot of social media stuff could be on this, we'll return to that in a future top 10 list. It is the anonymity that is provided by being in a car and people become their true selves. Mm-hmm. And the test of a person, I think, comes down to, you're in two lanes that are merging into one. What happens? It's very simple. One car goes and then the other car goes.
Yep.
And then one car goes, that's it.
Yep.
And all you have to do is go along with that. But when you try to break it, or when you act as if the lane hasn't narrowed enough yet, so you pretend, even though the lines are no longer there, and maybe this is three lanes, I don't know, whoops, I'm just shooting along the side. No. You know what you are doing. You are effectively Lucifer at that point. You care so little about everyone else, and your life is so important and where you gotta get to, that I have now become an a-hole on the other side. I have made myself an avenger against this. When the lines go away, I don't care how big that lane is. I am parking my little Scion in the exact middle of it, and I don't care what people think.
I will enforce
the social order.
No.
See,
I disagree. Well, because that just creates more traffic. I think as long as it's space. No, you're creating more traffic. No,
I'm not.
You are, because you have to use the space available. Otherwise, you're the a-hole because someone else is stuck in the middle of the effing, you know, intersection. So you have to use the space available.
No, I'm not talking about an intersection. I'm talking about like a highway.
2x2x2x2 until there's no more space, and then you go to one. But don't, when there's room for two cars, be a little bitch and put yourself right in the middle there.
I'm
and
be gonna like, be that bitch. It stops now. Okay, the man is gonna stop it. You will get behind me, because otherwise, I'm not just screwing over like myself by letting people do that. If I let them go by, they'll pass people in front of me. I'm screwing over the people ahead of me in the line by letting them get.
No. Because you're scared little asses. You guys are the ones, because I'm on the side and I will let you go. But you're the one who's like, you're not going to let me go. You're not going to. I'm like, no, I will let you go. I'm just utilizing the space. You're not going to let me go. And you know, there's a little bit of that happens.
I let people merge in, even though I hate when like you're in a long line to get on and someone goes up to the very end, they're like, oh, come on, I didn't know this was happening. I don't drive this way every single day. I will allow that sometimes.
Yes.
With the merging thing, it is originally, it was a principle. Now, I relish it. I love parking my Scion in the middle.
You're the zipper enforcer. And on the flip side, you know there are people who-
Zipper enforcer.
You know there are people who, when it's a clear zipper, they get offended that you're even trying to merge into like supposedly their lane. And you're like, bro-
Well, that's wrong too. It's like, a zipper. Like, yeah. I've never heard it called that, but that's what it is.
Yeah.
Anyway, I just don't like it. There's lots of the turn signal stuff, and like I don't understand why people feel like they need to be like a foot and a half behind the car in front of them. Like, give it a buffer. I don't understand why people do that. There's a lot of stuff that bothers me, but nothing as much as the merging thing. That's my number one.
It's a good one.
Anyway, I'm sure there's a lot that we left off the list. So if you're watching this and you have ideas, please post them below. And if you have ideas for future top 10 lists, you can also suggest those below as well. And we'll get to them in future weeks. But as always, Francesca, thank you so much for doing this.
Thank you.
And for those of you out there who are supporting us as members, making this possible, thank you as well. We look forward to doing these every week for you. And we will see you with the next one.
Check out the Damage Report podcast each day, wherever you get your podcasts, whether Pocket Casts or Stitcher or iTunes. You can join me as I give you the news and stories you want, with a range of co-hosts and interview guests jumping in on the fun each day. Again, that's the Damage Report, wherever you get your podcasts. And if you get them at iTunes, don't forget to rate and review. Sometimes I'll read them live on the show.